everyone. Welcome. So today we have a special treat. We have a guest speaker. So her name is Marina Henke. Professor Marina Henke comes from Northwestern University. You saw the bio. The bio is really rich, so I'm going to have to look at it in order to describe what she's accomplished thus far. So, Northwestern University assistant professor right now, holds a PhD in politics and public policy from Princeton University. Has a double MS, not quite sure what that means, in development studies and international political economy from Sciences Po. Also, London School of Economics, right? So that's probably what it means, double MS. Got it. And a BA also from Sciences Po. So this is a book, or rather a spin-off project. Spin-off project from a larger research program started by Professor Henke, which is about the determinants of the politics of coalitions. And she will be speaking for about 45 minutes, follow up with a Q&A, and if you have any questions, perhaps it's okay to interrupt, maybe ask for clarification. That seems to be the norm around here. So without further ado, please, the floor is yours, and join me in thanking Professor Henke for coming.
Delighted to be here. I told Professor Butchitek before that this is my second time in Ottawa. And the first time I was here, I was 15 years old. I'm German, and my parents had sent me here to learn English. Well, you can see by now I speak a little bit. And this is thanks to my stay here in Ottawa, Canada. I switched my from a very strong German accent in the beginning. I think it's a little bit more American now, but still not entirely. So when Professor Butchitek invited me, he said, this is going to be your session on alliances. And I will talk a bit about alliances. So who thinks that alliances are important, and that especially that they're important to recruit states to participate in military intervention? Who thinks alliances are important? You in the green shirt, why do you think alliances are important?
I guess they're important because they build kind of partnerships throughout the globe, and it kind of can lead to also like economic alliances and trade partnerships and things like that, as opposed to strictly military alliances.
Okay. So do you think that Canada participated in the Afghanistan intervention in ISAF? I'm sure you know right what happened. Because of NATO? I think NATO was kind of the key vehicle that convinced folks here on, the parliament that I saw just a minute ago, that because of NATO, because of Canadian participation in NATO, they had to go to Afghanistan. Who can help it? You raised your hand before.
Oh, I was gonna add the importance of alliances has to do with what is shared resources, but also it adds legitimacy to the intervention itself.
Why legitimacy?
Well, when you have more states, especially when you have within the Anglosphere, when you have certain states be part of the coalition, it adds a certain legitimacy. But what you're asking why it adds a certain legitimacy.
So who's the audience for this?
The world.
The world. So if they see this is a NATO intervention, people think that it's more legitimate than it's just a Canadian intervention, U.S. intervention.
Yes, I think so.
Yeah.
Well,
yes.
Well, I disagree with that because, as in your article, you have an example of Canada not joining U.S. in Korean War because Quebec was against it. So then, this is something that. So Minister Pearson decided not to do it because of public opinion. So. Even though it was legitimate because there were so many countries going, but Canada did not.
Well, in the end, they participated a little bit.
Yeah.
But they had, struggle convincing the public, especially in Quebec. So here is kind of what the literature says about why alliances affect coalition participation, in particular U.S. coalition participation. First, U.S. allies tend to share U.S. threat perception and norms and values. Right? This is kind of the idea that why alliances formed in the first place. So you have countries who kind of like think the Soviet Union is a threat, and this is why they formed NATO. But then, even if they don't necessarily share all the preferences in the first place, they tend to align, or at least this is what Morrow and Altfeld and Skeeda argued, they tend to align their foreign policy interests to signal credibility, right? Because in essence, an alliance is always a deterrence mechanism, a deterrence institution. So if you have very distinct foreign policies, then this deterrence isn't really credible. Or alternatively, of course, there's this alliance security dilemma. Have you heard of this alliance security dilemma before? It's kind of the idea that that large parties alliance, but sometimes as well, the smaller ones, they get trapped in an alliance. So if a smaller country wants to engage in a conflict abroad, the larger one has to help the little one as well to kind of maintain the credibility of the alliance, and vice versa. So if the large party in the United States wants to, for example, intervene in Iraq, smaller allies like Great Britain and Canada, you know, they are in a way compelled to participate because they might need the United States in a conflict that they are interested in the future. Okay, so that's kind of this trade-off. I have to help my ally now, and then the ally will help in the future. And this is what it's generally called, the alliance security. And then finally, the argument has been made, why do alliances affect U.S. coalition contributions? Because alliances engage in training, in interoperability, mechanisms, and all of these kind of activities, they enhance the fighting capability, and so in a way the alliance becomes very strong, and so the prospect of winning a war increases. And when the likelihood of winning a war are pretty high, then a lot of countries are willing to participate because, you know, it seems to be a good deal. Okay? So in essence, you have these four arguments why alliances should considerably affect U.S. coalition participation. There's some other arguments as well. Coercion or hierarchy. David Lake, who is at the University of San Diego, he wrote a big book on hierarchy, and he said, in essence, the United States either directly or indirectly threatens countries, forces them, coerces them to participate by manipulating, for example, foreign aid flows, trade flows, or a larger set of hierarchical structures. And then, of course, here our own Professor Vucetic, he pointed more to these normative explanations, their shared identities, socialization processes that happen, however, outside of alliance structures. Okay? For example, in the Anglosphere, where democracies tend to fight alongside and for each other. So, what I present in the paper is a little bit of a different explanation. It doesn't reject everything that has been said about alliances and these explanations, but it's a little bit of a twist. And the key argument I'm making is that actually what has been overlooked, at least not explicitly stated thus far, is the fact that allies almost never just coalesce automatically. Okay? So it's not the case that the United States says, we want to go to Afghanistan, and that boom, 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 everybody kind of like coalesces together and shh, they deploy, okay? Actually, every single U.S. coalition effort involves very intense negotiations, okay? And they are led by the United States. And these intense negotiations, they, yes, involve the military aspects of the deployment, so military strategy, what type of troops to deploy, and so forth, but what is probably even more important, these negotiations deal with economic, financial, and other political benefits that the coalition participants expect to gain from participation. Okay? And later on, the case studies, I will give you examples of what actually these economic benefits are. So what happens is that in all types of negotiations, information is the key variable, right? This is what economists and, you know, as well as political scientists, sociologists have determined. Why why is information so important in negotiations?
Well, that's where the diplomacy helps, because diplomats kind of try to get as much information as possible to see if other countries are interested, and what are the inner talks in the country, would they be even interested, should we approach them? Did they express any slight interest in joining us?
I think the more you know about the other country, as well as their own values, because of like their financial, economic, or political views, would help as well.
Yeah.
I think when there's negotiations going on or considerations to join a coalition, there's obviously some form of cost-benefit analysis, and without sufficient information, you really can't make a well-informed decision.
Exactly. Because then even if you negotiate with your mom or your best friend, there's always a little bit of a flexibility in your, you know, initial bargaining statement, so to speak. You know, so if you want to sell a computer, you probably start it, I want $500, right? But the truth is that probably you would sell it as well for $350. And so there's always this idea, where actually is the red line, right? And even you catch yourself next time when you negotiate with your mom. You always exaggerate a little bit, you know? And this is why sometimes these negotiations can break down, because both parties exaggerate too much, and they kind of, you know, the uncertainty about where the actual red lines are not clear. And the more information you have about these real preferences, real red lines of the negotiating partners, the greater the likelihood that these negotiations actually succeed. And this is why information is so crucial. So the problem with alliance ties is that, for the most part, they open information channels with regards to security and defense policy. Right? So when you have a NATO summit, the information that is exchanged focuses more or less on capabilities, on strategy, on postures, and so forth, right? And if you have a small socialization mechanisms, but predominantly among folks who kind of work on these issues. But as I mentioned before, initially, you know, 80% of these coalition negotiations, you don't just focus on the secure and defense issues, but other issues, economic, financial, political issues, such as, for example, what the Quebecois think about Korea, get tied in. And to have access on these types of issues, US officials need to use all other bilateral and multinational ties as well that they have established. Because in essence, every single tie opens information channels. So if you have an environmental agreement with a third party, or an immigration agreement, or culture agreements, social agreements, that means each time some kind of counterpart on both sides talk about it, right? Even during the negotiation process, you already kind of assess where the other party stands, what more or less the preferences are, what they want, what they're seeking. And this information that gets collected in the moment of coalition negotiation. So how does this work in reality? So in essence, when the United States plans to launch a coalition, they sit down and establish so-called prospect lists. I've done a lot of research on this, and literally starting with the Korean War in 1950, every single time in Vietnam, the Gulf War, Afghanistan, Kosovo, and so forth, they have these prospect lists. And in essence, it is a selection of countries that they think are good candidates to negotiate over. Okay, so sometimes you just put 20 countries on the list, sometimes 40, 50, and so forth. Because it's just impossible to negotiate with everybody, and that is about, like, you know, nonsense. So here's an example of what criteria factor into the selection process of what kind of countries, you know, make it on that process. Well, first, it is about what can a state potentially bring to the table, right? So what can they contribute to the coalition? That concerns troops, equipment, as well as quality of the troops, what they can do, can they provide niche capabilities, the number of troops, but then sometimes as well you have political assets. So for example, Kosovo, they wanted to have some Muslim countries, serving in the NATO coalition because they're dealing with, you know, Muslim Bosnians, so they try to bring in either Morocco or Egypt or Tunisia into the coalition, and so on. The second question then is, how much of the potential participant intrinsically care to be a member of the coalition? Okay, this is more or less establishing the red line, what I just mentioned before. If they intrinsically care about the security issue at hand, the side deal, the side payment they require needs to be very small, right? Because in essence, they already won the war. But if you know that they are not that particularly interested in this intervention, but you want them for these reasons, because you think that they can bring something significant to the table, the side payment needs to be much larger. And in essence, the other party, the third party that you deem valuable, has quite some leverage in the negotiations. So for example, if you want to bring in Turkey because you think you can stage, or you have, you know, have staging bases there, or you know, transit your troops through Turkey, and so on. And then finally, there's this third criteria. This is like, what type of external incentive can the United States offer to that country so that it comes over the board? And here, sometimes it's money, as you can see in a minute, but very often this is, well, this is a trade agreement, it can be, you know, some kind of visa waiver, so, you know, a World Bank loan. The breadth here is unbelievable. And again, the information that they get on both of these is very often retrieved through these ties that they have. So here's an example of a document that I picked up at the Lyndon B. Johnson Library in Austin, Texas. So Lyndon B. Johnson, as you know, was the US president during the Vietnam escalation. And here, this is John T. McNaughton, who was the Assistant Secretary for Defense in this administration, sent a memo to McBundy, who was the National Security Advisor. And in essence, it's exactly, you know, like one type of these prospect lists that I just mentioned. And I hope you can read that, maybe it's a little bit. But in essence, you have four categories of countries that the United States deems, you know, worthy to have negotiations with for Vietnam. So the first one is category A, and here they say, well, these guys already have troops in Vietnam. So that's Korea, Australia, and New Zealand. So maybe we can ask for some more troops, but in essence, they're already set. And then category B, in here, it says pressure, 300 to 500 million to play with, and priorities on deliveries of COMSHA. So COMSHA is basically site payments, right? So I don't have to tell you. We should be able to get Korea, China, but that's Taiwan, Philippines, Australia, Thailand, and Greece. And then here it's even more specific, right? So, you know, what exactly they would require to participate. But they still think that this is kind of the easy category. Then category C, on longer term and longer shots, in some cases involving selling our souls and raising hop in various ways, are Turkey, Germany, UK, Israel, Spain. Okay? And again, they kind of project what these countries would require. And then they're in a way excluded, omitted for obvious reason, though the capability exists, are Canada, India, Pakistan, Lebanon, Japan, Argentina, Brazil, Chile, Peru. Okay, so you can see clearly they're in a way three different categories, what I mentioned before. What could they bring to the table? One division, 7,000, right? Sometimes these prospect lists are even more specific. They can bring helicopters, they can bring these types of things. Then a category, how much they're intrinsically interested, right? So probably, you know, interested, a little bit interested, not so much interested, not at all. And then these expectations of what they would need as a site payment, right? Here you need 300 to 500 million. Here you literally, you know, need to sell your soul. And then, so this is kind of an overview, but then they have specific reports as well that you can find at the at the library, for example, just for Turkey. And in these special reports, you can realize then as well where they got the information from. Okay. How could they discern that Turkey was in the second category and would require XYZ? And for the most part, it was either acquired by these bilateral interactions, okay, ambassadors, or defense attachés, or some kind of local contacts said, you know, we need XYZ to bring Turkey on board, or even the Secretary of State or the President himself talked to the Turkish president, other high officials at multilateral summits. Actually, multilateral summits, even if they're, you know, economic summits, the UN General Assembly, they're hotbeds for these coalition negotiations, because in corridor discussions, or even, you know, they meet in the restroom, literally, and they raise these issues. Okay, they collect information on what kind of side deals third country would be interested in, and then they can construct these deals. So, what are the other benefits of diplomatic ambassadors? It creates as well trust. Now, very often, countries know about an opportunity for a side deal negotiation, but there is a lack of trust. This is a little bit the difference with Russia. Russia 10 years ago and Russia now. 10 years ago, the United States literally paid Russia a lot of money for help with the Afghanistan intervention, because in essence there was still a sufficient degree of trust that they would take the money but then as well fulfill their part of the agreement and let American troops and other troops transit and refuel and so forth. Today, you know, in my interviews I heard that the trust has decreased. So trust is a crucial factor as well in this type of negotiation. And what happens very often as well, that existing institutions and institutional links are used to channel these side payments. So actually for the United States, it's much easier to transfer money, for example, through the World Bank indirectly or through the United Nations or through some other channel than creating a new budget line. And this is mostly because if they create these new budget lines, then they have, you know, Congress oversight or other kind of parties asking a lot of questions. Right? But if you already have an aid budget or some kind of, you know, other loan agreement, you can just like double it, triple it, and it's much easier because it's a little bit hidden. And people don't ask that many questions in particular. And then, of course, you know, there's as well coercive cooperation. So yes, the United States can use existing aid deals or trade deals to manipulate them and then force countries on board. But so, you know, to this question, how does hierarchy and these, you know, diplomatic embeddedness interact? Very often, you know, I find this quite astounding. Coalition negotiations are the only instance, or one of the very few instances, where actually these weaker parties have a real say. And why? Because they know the United States wants them on board, okay? And even in the Iraq conflict, right? So the Bush administration 2002, 2003 was desperate to have coalition members because nobody wanted to participate in the Iraq invasion. So if you are even a Tonga, right, or a Georgian, you know that the United States right now, in essence, needs you more than you need them, at least in this particular context. So actually, you can ask for something, because normally, you know, when it's always Georgia who wants more military aid, more equipment, a better trade deal, right? So it's always Georgia in the asking side. And here it's actually the United States who is asking Georgia to do something. So I'm not saying that hierarchy is completely absent, of course, right? I mean, diplomatic networks are part of this American power infrastructure, like guns, like money, like ideas and so forth. But it is still, there's a little bit of an, you know, advantage because, you know, the power of each government is, in essence, inversely proportional to the relative value it places on an agreement. And often the United States is more interested in having these coalition partners participate in the coalition than the coalition partners want to participate in the coalition. So, Professor Vucicic said, give them stats. So, you will get some statistics. first replicate study to kind of illustrate this theory about the importance of diplomatic empire. That was done by David Lick. And he, in essence, tries to prove that hierarchy is the key variable in enticing these coalition partners. So he has one dependent variable, it's a binary dependent variable, saying if our country participates, one, doesn't participate, zero. His key independent variable is hierarchy. He has two indexes that try to capture how much a state is dependent either on the United States' security umbrella or on economic ties of the United States. And I add to his analysis my independent variable, which is in essence diplomatic embeddedness, and it's the number of joint international governmental organization memberships and bilateral ties. So I count all the treaties that the United States has established for the country and all the joint IO memberships. And here are the results. So this is first a replication of Lake. And you can see here what matters a lot. Probability increases a lot if you're very dependent in security terms on the United States and as well in and then military expenditure is quite important. It increases your likelihood of participating. And whether you are in the same region as the operation, joint primary language that speaks to the Anglosphere is quite important. UN legitimation, and so on. But if I add diplomatic embeddedness, you see that security hierarchy, you know, is not important anymore. And this is more important. And everything else more or less stays the same.
Could you tell us for a moment, number of the observations, how do you count them and why do you have 1,500 as opposed to some other number?
So the unit of analysis is participant operation, right? There are 15 operations in this data set, but you have roughly, I think it's about 90 countries per operation that potentially could have joined. Okay. And so you just add this up, 90 times 15, more or less, right? So, but you're asking already a good question, because actually, you know, 15 coalitions is a very small number. And that's why I'm extending Lake's analysis, because I think that in particular after the end of the Cold War, and especially after Black Hawk Down, what happened in Black Hawk Down? Did you watch the movie? Black Hawk Down, nobody. Marky Mark?
We discussed it in class.
Somalia in 1994. What happened in Somalia? Yes. In the red shirt.
The Americans sent a mission trying to capture Muhammad Farah ID, but they met some amount of resistance. And when a helicopter was shot down, they got a lot of soldiers bogged down trying to rescue the people who had been in the helicopter. And eventually there was a relatively small number of American casualties and a large number of Somali casualties in the battle that came after.
And as well, Pakistani casualties. Yeah. But they grabbed a dead American serviceman, and dragged him through the streets of Mogadishu, right? And it was captured by CNN and other TV cameras. And kind of, you know, like in the United States, there was this uproar. What are the Americans doing in this, you know, godforsaken country? Yeah, and this is not my words, this is the words of general public opinion at the time. Okay. And it dramatically shifted American public opinion vis-a-vis peacekeeping. In essence, after 1994, the United States withdrew from peacekeeping operations, in particular in Africa, but as well in general. You know, and they said, you're more in charge of war fighting. Peacekeeping, okay? And this is one of the reasons, probably the key reason, why nothing happened in Rwanda, because they didn't intervene. They were still under shock of the Somalia intervention, the Rwanda genocide. So, and what happened then was that the United States actually started to outsource as well a lot of these peacekeeping operations. So in essence, it is not the United States deploys the largest number of troops, but still it orchestrates the entire political process to launch these operations. Okay, this is basically the case for the Haiti interventions, for Liberia, for Ethiopia, and for Sudan. We have a massive Sudan lobby in the United States that is very interested there. And even the UN operation then, and Haiti operations, which are technically launched under the United Nations, the what I call a pivotal state, right, so the mastermind, the political mastermind behind these operations, is the United States. And the United States have plenty of documents that show that US ambassadors and even, you know, government officials at the highest level, the President Bush, solicits troop contributions for these interventions. But it's a very select number. So the United States is not behind every single UN operation, but some, yeah, that they are particularly interested in. Okay? And so I add these cases to the data set. So then it's not just 15 operations, it actually, so I extend it to 2015, and have as well these, you know, Haiti and Korea and Darfur and so forth. Okay. And again, I stick very closely to the specifications of the model. I just add one more, two more dependent variables. So bit more specific than later. Just look at overall participation, but as well as substantive participation. So if you send at least 100 troops to kind of control for token contributions, but the rest in essence is the same. And here's what you see. And actually, so again, the United Nations is very important, but US alliance is now even negatively contributing. So US alliance partners are actually less likely to participate. By the way, I run a robustness check where I take out all the UN operations and the results hold. So it's not about the UN. Some people say, well, the UN's stupid. Okay, fine. It still holds. And then you have, you know, many more observations. The data set is much larger. For some of you, you know, maybe the statistical results are difficult to interpret, so this is the predicted. So in essence, the mean of diplomatic abandonment is 70 times. Okay? The mean, you have a probability of roughly 17% to participate in the US coalition. But that jumps to almost 30% at one standard deviation. So if you have about 128 times, that's quite substantial. It's less if you just look at the substantive contributions. Okay? There it's from, you know, roughly 4%. To about 8, and then the two standard deviations here. You're about 15, and you're, you know, 45 for overall participation. So actually, this is quite important. So let me give you a case example to illustrate what's going on. And it takes, you know, what political scientists would say, a hard case, because I take the Korean War. And in essence, Korean War, as you know, started in 1950, 1951, 52, 53, and it was right at the beginning of the Cold War, right? It was, the US had lost China to the communists in 1949, the Berlin Crisis had happened, so in essence, you would think that alliances were absolutely crucial, right? The free world realizes that the Soviet Union is evil, so to speak, you know? And so, if alliances are not that important in the Korean War, well, maybe they might not be that important actually in other cases. So here you have the participants in the Korean War, South Korea, the UK, Canada, Turkey, Australia, Philippines, New Zealand, Ethiopia, Greece, Thailand, France, Colombia, Belgium, South Africa, the Netherlands, Luxembourg. And first, I just give a couple examples here, but a lot of these countries, not all, but a lot, got these little side payments. Okay? So Philippines, $478 million. The ties, the negotiated economic and technical cooperation agreement, and then as well a military assistance agreement, and then what is interesting, the very first World Bank loan ever given to a non-European country, a developing country. And this was as well all orchestrated by the United States. Ethiopia got a lot of equipment, arms deals, and India negotiated $80,000 for the transportation to Korea, and then $50,000 per month for the pipeline team. You know, similar deals were negotiated for Turkey, for Greece, for South Africa, and you have some examples in the paper. So how did this happen? Well, again, I spent a lot of time at the Truman Library, where you have all these documents from the Korean War, because Truman was the president. And in the very beginning, because it was in essence the first coalition that was built after the Second World War, so it was the first limited war, so to speak, war for choice. Right? And there was a lot of confusion inside the U.S. administration of how these coalitions should work. And in the beginning, Truman said, Department of Defense, you take over. And the Department of Defense, the military generals, yes, they were a lot concerned about the military capabilities that countries could bring to the table. So they would write these letters, basically to like all the alliance partners and say, you know, we're seeking men, 10,000 troops, they have to be fully equipped, et cetera, et cetera. How many said that they would participate? What's your guess? What was the response to these letters?
Not a lot.
Exactly. Very, very, very few. Also, the time was kind of like, sure.
How many requests were sent out?
About 30. Yeah. 30. But they looked all the same. It was very much standard, And then you're like, best regards, President Truman.
And like, what kind of states?
All the NATO allies. And then, like a bunch of countries in the United States film, ranking in Asia. And at the same time, so while they're still like waiting for the responses, the Soviet Union was launching this quite impressive propaganda campaign at the United Nations. Because basically they saw that nobody was showing up. And then they said, look, this is the proof that Korea is not a free world campaign against the Soviet Union, but it's actually, orchestrated endeavor by the United States. Okay, this is the proof that the United States is not fighting for, the West, but this is just for themselves. And so then Truman and the Secretary of State at the time, the National Secretary, were really angry and said, this needs to stop. Right? We need to pretend, or at least, have, some credibility in our claim that you're doing this for the free world and not just for us. Right? You're defending South Korea not just for the purpose of the United States, but for everybody who's, not under the Soviet umbrella. And so Truman literally ordered, and it wasn't easy, but they said, DOD, Department of Defense, you stop with the recruitment process because you suck. Yeah. It was not a nice memo. I should have shown you. And State Department, you take over. And this is when, the State Department establishes the prospectus. And again, you have a lot of documents and how they then try to find countries that they can approach for these coalition contributions. And I'll just give you some examples. For example, they put Uruguay on the list because they knew that they were interested in arms sales. Brazil wanted to remain a non-permanent member of the UN Security Council. They were more interested in economic aid, US export credits, steel equipment. Actually, very detailed these, the different, side payments that potentially could be negotiated and the U.S. had picked up. Chile was interested as well in military equipment, but they had a lot of public opinion concerns. Canada had trouble with Quebec. And Turkey, for example, wanted a security commitment from the United States and money. So they wanted that the United States basically covers the entire deployment. And so with this information, then, the United States structured the negotiations and as well managed to channel all of the side payments through already existing institutions. Okay? And some of them then, contributed, as you saw, Turkey, Canada agreed, and the others at the negotiations didn't actually. So, in essence, what does this say? Well, multilateralism is actually the standard doctrine of U.S. intervention policy in the States. Even in a case of Iraq, when UN approval is not considered important, still the United States wanted other countries involved. Since Panama, the Panama intervention in 1988, the United States has never overtly deployed alone. But the big question is how important actually is alliance time? And I would say that maybe they're not as we assume they are. And that's all I have to present.
Well, this is great. Since you're exceedingly comfortable in this seminar room, I suggest you take the questions yourself. And let's open it up for discussion. We have plenty of time.
Yes,
your conclusion. So coalitions are not important.
No, alliances are not the coalitions.
And the difference between the two are?
Oh, fundamental. So an alliance is an agreement. Is a treaty. So it basically says, in case of something happening, for example, NATO context, in case the Soviet Union attacks the NATO countries, all the other NATO countries have to come and defend that country. Right? So it's an agreement. A coalition is already, so it's an action. Right? So a country already says, we deploy to Iraq, and all of you can come join. So an alliance, in essence, is your project. You know, you're kind of saying, in the future, I come help you. But right now, I'm not doing much. I mean, I might help you prepare, you know, deter. But in this particular moment, you're not deploying. Okay? And this is an alliance treaty. You know, then you have wartime alliances, and very often it's mixed. But alliance treaties, in essence, are just agreements. A coalition is an action.
I would also say that coalition is something more short term.
Exactly.
It's only for a specific task, and when it's over, it's over.
Exactly.
Where alliances are more.
Exactly. Very good. Thanks for adding.
If alliances are less important for deciding what the troop contributions look like, how important are they for that prospects list and for how much the states, in this example, chooses to sort of figure out how much they'll have to contribute to get them on board?
So, you know, I think like the United States always looks at the alliance partners. But when they negotiate over, you know, whether the alliance partner then actually becomes a member of the coalition, these alliance ties always like almost, you know, like I'll become, almost, I mean, you know, sometimes they're tied in, you know, the negotiations, but they're not visible, right? And then they negotiate over like, you know, trade agreements and economic agreements. Actually, I don't have the chart here because it wasn't part of this talk, but every single of these Eastern European countries that deployed to Afghanistan, okay, received a lot of money from the United States. Poland received $1 billion to go to Iraq. Okay, so then you kind of have to look, $1 billion here, NATO ally, right? And what was more important? I would say that probably both. But if the United States hadn't paid the $1 billion and it was just a NATO ally, I would say that Poland probably wouldn't have deployed. I think probably, you know, the $1 billion was then more important than just the membership. But of course there's an interaction. So I'm not saying that alliance are completely irrelevant. But it's probably not, it's not common threats, you know, that drive these coalition contributions. It's something else.
So what are the counter steps against less faithful like allies? Like I'm thinking about Turkey always having creating problem with the United States.
You know, I'm delighted that you asked about Turkey because I actually spent an entire month in Turkey just finding out what actually happened on this famous March 1st when the Turkish parliament rejected the deal. Are you from Turkey?
No,
no?
I'm not.
Okay. And it had a lot to do with actually failed coalition negotiations, money negotiations. Okay? And so what happens to them? Yes, you know, I spoke to a very famous Turkish scholar and said, the fact that Erdogan became so powerful right now, and the military is so weak in Turkey, I don't know how it's about the Turkish situation, had, you know, some people say, had put in one way or another, you know, be related to what happened on this March 1st. Why? Because the U.S. military was really angry with Turkey, okay, when Turkey rejected to participate in the Iraq war. Before, the American military and the Turkish military had extremely close relationships, and as well, a lot of, you know, socialization was going on, and exchange. change this and so forth. And so the last moment the US military thought, the Turkish military would push the government and they would participate. For the American military as well, the Northern Front, if you have a map here, the Northern Front for Turkey was very important. Because now, in essence, you had 250,000 US troops who all had to transit through Kuwait. Okay? That's a lot of troops through a tiny little bottleneck. And you know, if you could go through the north, Turkey, much more space. So the military, the US military actually said the Northern Front is absolutely crucial. And they were, you know, behind the scenes they're pushing the Turkish military to make a difference. But they couldn't, or they didn't want to, you know, I would say that they couldn't. It fell through, right? And particular Abdul Rabiul, who was the prime minister at the time, he, you know, said, I don't want to participate, we don't want to do this. And then the American military really upset and basically handed over, it's literally what they said, you know, they had these massive piles of dossiers, you know, so to speak, like these are all relations with Turkey, and said, State Department, you can't deal with this, you know, we don't want to deal with Turkey anymore, they were really upset. And instead of so always being the lobbyist for the Turkish military, the American military stood back and said, you disappointed us, you're not going to defend you. So a lot of the mill-mill cooperation agreements as well, like just the pushing Congress for more aid money, for, you know, in a way, protection of the Turkish military kind of stopped, or at least declined quite significantly. And this is one of the reasons why the military in Turkey right now is quite weak. Various reasons, right? But this is one of the reasons as well. It might, you know, in a way, Erdogan could really decimate them quite dramatically and decimate them. That might be good, right? I'm not making a normative statement here. I'm just saying these are the facts. Turkish military is very weak right now. Yeah.
So if you have a country that doesn't really have an intrinsic or doesn't see the intrinsic value in helping you out, when they ask for money, is it just to cover the costs, or is there some sort of like net gain in the end, like some sort of revenue they make from going to war?
Yes, for the most part. So there are two different types of agreements. You know, sometimes it's just covering the cost, but then very often they still have some kind of intrinsic interest in the operation. But then yes, you see literally a modern, you know, mercenaries, you know, basically saying we're participating in this because we're making money.
So I was going to say, so I would imagine that if you're an ally and you lack the funds to go to war, it's that you're not looking for revenue, but rather just enough to, you know, help them out.
Yeah.
Is that how it is usually, or?
And you know, in essence, I mean, so, you know, Poland is not the richest country on the planet, but it's not a poor country, right? I mean, by no means. It's a member of the European Union, you know, it's doing just fine. So could they have, you know, paid for the entire Iraq intervention? In technical terms, yes, right. Probably, you know, they maybe, you know, would have reduced, I don't know, education or health spending or something like that, you know, highway construction. but could they raise $1 billion? Of course, if it was an absolute tremendous threat, right, that they felt that they had to defend themselves, of course they could raise $1 billion, right? But they didn't, right? And it was a political choice that they preferred to take the money from the United States or from Poland. Of course, then the question is, either was the United States stupid, right, and paid them all that they could have raised the money, right? Or was it literally that the United States knew that Poland wouldn't come if they didn't get the money, right? And I would say that actually the United States knew that Poland wouldn't come, or at least had a much smaller contingent. Maybe they would have sent 1,500 people, but they actually sent, was it 2,500 or something like that? This was the third largest contingent. Yeah.
So they compared that to Turkey. Could they have given Turkey a bigger incentive?
So yeah, this was actually the entire deal. What people, you know, don't really talk about. There was a last-ditch effort led by Turkey back in the day had somewhat of a, you know, split government. So you had Abdullah Gül, and then you had Erdogan, who was kind of, you know, the face of the party. Now he's big Erdogan. But back in the day, he was banned from politics. So he was acting behind the scenes, but technically he didn't have any real power, okay? I mean, in constitutional power, okay? He couldn't sign any letters. He still had power in the party, but he couldn't first ban had to be on Iran. So the Americans were only negotiating with Erdogan because Richard Perle and Paul Wolfowitz were very important people in the U.S. administration at the time. They knew Erdogan from before. So they kind of like, you know, said like, you're our buddy, we negotiate. And then in essence, a package deal was made. And Gül, the prime minister, was excluded. And then the ready-made package was presented to Gül. And Gül said, well, where's my part of the pie?
Right.
And then Gül sent, you know, 1 week before March 1st, sent his confidant to Washington and said, I want my piece of the pie as well. And the Americans rejected it.
Oh, I see.
And then Gül said, okay, too bad. It's not going to happen.
Oh, I see.
And then actually what nobody really knows, I mean, now it becomes, because Gül now stepped, you know, down. He's not in the government anymore, so we'll talk about it more. But actually in Parliament, he rallied his own troops to vote against it.
Oh, yes.
Just to follow up on this comparison between Poland and Turkey, right? So unlike the Poles, whose supply of goods and services exceeded the demand, they really wanted, the military wanted to fight. They wanted to be the tip of the spear to go together with the Brits and the Australians and the Americans and invade the first day. The Turks never even considered sending troops because of the Kurdish problem and other things. Instead, their participation was always access rights, flyover rights, the use of Incirlik base, right? How do you account for that variation in types of participation? Because right now you operationalize participation in terms of troops, 100 or more. But if sometimes what's really important for the United States is access.
Basing
rights. Right, basing rights. Maybe even votes. I mean, it could be hundreds of things that we could use to measure participation and not troops.
Yeah. So actually, in the final agreement, the Turks did send troops. Mm-hmm. I mean, in the end, they never sent troops because it, you know, it
right.
passed.
Right.
They wanted to put all the troops in the north side, in the Kurdish area. So it was very controversial. But the United States actually agreed. So yes, there was I think it was 10,000 troops that were in the agreement that would have been actually deployed in the north. So there was participation. But of course, yes, of course there is a distinction. And you have Scott Wolford, who codes it, you know, who says basically if you grant these basing rights or transit rights, you're a member of the coalition, also you don't send troops. For the statistical analysis, I just count true participation. For, you know, my book, hopefully you're all going to buy it.
Do you also have some kind of a sensitivity analysis in which you have operationalized participation in terms of troops per population? Because in New Zealand sending, you know, 1,300 to Korea is a very large number for New Zealand, and this is an old argument. And if so, what does it say?
So, in essence, you know, nobody mobilizes the entirety of their military, right? So the sensitivity when it comes to, you know, whether it's 5% of the military or 10% of the military, isn't in essence that. Yet it matters when, you know, in case you look at the very precise payment that you see, right? Then it's kind of like it's an issue of negotiation. But if you just want to measure, you know, whether they participated or not, and what kind of links it creates, I don't think, you know, like it's like, but it's a general.
I wanted to go back to your conclusion. It's like, I'm still trying to make sense of it. So you're saying alliances are more important than coalition, but ultimately, at least within a military context, in terms of intervention, the purpose of those alliances is to make sure that there's capability there for a coalition,
exactly.
Or that it serves a coalition. So.
And that's why it's so absurd.
If the agreements or if the alliances cannot go through to have a coalition and a successful intervention, the alliances are not doing what they're supposed to do. So they're both very important, but you're saying that irrelevant, like relevant to each other. Alliances are more important.
No, so I don't try to make a judgment about importance.
Okay.
I'm just saying that alliances do not necessarily generate true contributions. Okay. So you can have NATO, and NATO can have a million benefits.
Okay.
Socialization and innovation and research and development and what, but it doesn't mean that the NATO alliance can actually generates troops for the U.S. coalition. That's what I'm saying. Okay. So, but in general, what people suspect is that you have NATO for them if the United States wants to deploy and wants to fight an enemy. NATO is there, and provide the troops. But I'm actually saying that NATO is, the NATO allies do not share the same threats as the United States. And I would even say, I read Chrétien's biography, and when he rejected to participate in the Iraq intervention, the key word he had at the time was not that the United States was retaliating on a security level, but actually he was worried that, negotiations, I think, on lumber or something like that would be stalled, that the United States would stop transport of trade, that they would ratchet up the border controls and these kind of things. So that, the backlashes he was worried about were all in this economic realm, right? And that already says something. So technically, in a perfect world, or like an alliance-dominated world, one would think, the United States sees this evil dictator in Iraq, right? Says that this evil dictator is threatening the entire free world, including Canada. Because if he uses nuclear weapons, Canada will be in one way or another affected, right? And so technically, Canada and France and Germany and the UK and Belgium, they all should be like, of course we're going to help the United States. We share these threat perceptions because we're alliance partners. But in essence, this is not what happened. Okay? A lot of countries said we don't share these threat perceptions, and other countries said, well, we participate, but not because we share these threat perceptions, but because you take them. Okay? So in essence, what technically the alliance was meant to be there for, right, didn't happen.
Okay, so you're pointing out capitalist aspects of war making. Okay.
Yeah. And I think there's a fundamental change. So alliances have their, this is a different discussion, they have their effects and their benefits, but they do not necessarily generate these true contributions as we see them in the size and the fashion.
Okay.
Yeah.
Since it's so costly for the U.S. to kind of have more and more coalition partners because they need the payments, they need favors, is there some kind of minimum level where they're like, okay, well, it's diverse enough and we have enough people that it's now legitimate in enough countries' eyes that we don't need to ask, five other countries and pay, $5 billion extra. So is there some kind of threshold where they're like, okay, we have countries in five continents, that's enough. You don't need
But it depends on a case by case basis, condition basis. But I want to add something to this. So why do you think the United States engages in this crazy effort, right, to pay all these troops and engage in all these negotiations? Why do you think that is so important? Why do they do? Because for Iraq, it was a nightmare. I talked to diplomats who were both with us, and it's like nobody wanted to contribute. We had to go to Tonga and to, Micronesia and whatnot, and it was not a good idea. So why do you think they do this?
Is it the L word that we were talking about earlier, legitimacy?
One key reason is legitimacy, but there's some other factors as well. Yeah.
They're trying to push their interests.
Who pushes their interests?
They want their own interests to play out on the global field scale.
On U.S. interests?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But they could do it, alone. Probably even more, maybe not effectively if you, if you look at legitimate concerns, but the United States doesn't need to have a Tonga in the coalition. They don't even need Poland, right?
maybe it kind of the multilateral approach takes the attention off the U.S. as being sort of coercive of single powerhouse intervening, things like this, and sort of is more, the world can accept it more as like democracy promotion and things like that.
It goes back to the legitimacy concern.
Yeah.
Two other reasons. First one is that actually it serves almost like an insurance policy. Okay, so if Iraq falls apart or if Afghanistan falls apart, you know, and if only the United States intervened, of course the entire world would just point the fingers and like, you did it, right? I mean, you break it, you own it. But if you have a bunch of other countries in the coalition, even if they just sent 5 troops, at least you could say, well, you know, 0.3% of the disaster belongs to you, right? So you have to help with the cleanup. That's the second reason. The third reason is that actually, believe it or not, sending U.S. soldiers abroad is extremely costly. The estimates that one soldier, if you add everything together, the deployment costs as well, healthcare costs, and the veterans care is about $1 million dollars per year per soldier, one soldier. And that's just, I mean, they're rough estimates, very hard. Some of them don't get sick, others get terribly sick. But if you pay, even so, for example, a Czech soldier got paid by the United States roughly $40,000. And then you had like different subsidies, so to speak, deployment allowance. And so 40,000 is nothing compared to a million, right? So actually for the United States, they make a benefit. If they have even one Czech soldier patrolling the camps or going, you know, like doing some kind of other business, it's cheaper than if the same job would have been done by a U.S. soldier. So there actually are these cost benefits. So in essence, they have three rationales. First one is legitimacy, and it's absolutely crucial, it matters a lot. So then there's this idea of an insurance policy. And third, it is cheap.
So what are your thoughts on private security firms? I mean, if this is a legitimate issue and this is discussed politically, and Kofi Annan was thinking about hiring private security firms in 94 in Rwanda, you know, it's at least something that they were discussing at the time. Why would the U.S. just hire Brazilians, Kenyans, Indians, Bangladeshis, whoever?
Through the security firms.
Right, and you know, 400,000 troops you have in Iraq, you can pacify, you can occupy, you can do whatever you want, exactly as General Shimonoseki was saying before the intervention. This is what we need to succeed.
Well, it goes back exactly to this legitimacy, right? So if the United States said, oh, and you're going to Iraq and we have, you know, hired all these peeps, these, you know, from, why not? Everybody would be like, what? You know, I mean, how can this be legitimate, right? This is literally, I mean, you're literally back, you know, like to pre-Napoleon eras where, you know, the Brits hired a bunch of, you know, German folks and from whatnot, Hessen, you know, like to fight the independence war in America.
What if this came with the UN fiat, right? What if it came from the Security Council?
I think what the United States is scared about as well is actually bargaining power. Mm-hmm. So right now, you know, you have these, you still have competition, right, believe it or not. So you have technically Bangladesh who could be interested in this mission, you have Uruguay, you have Indonesia now is getting the business, you know, other countries. And so the United States can use its diplomatic power, these kind of things, right, to negotiate between them, you know, and then take the cheapest offer. And for the United States, very often it's actually cheaper sometimes to negotiate a trade agreement than cash out. Right, like paid in cash. Security firms have to be paid in cash, right? And probably because they didn't know the business, they can set the prices. Blackwater is extremely expensive.
Yeah.
And so I think this is, they've used their leverage, and yes, we are, you know, again, we did this higher people to lower the price.
Yeah, add to that, I'll maybe human rights concerns, because if you're in a, you know, national army, there's certain standards and norms that you're expected, and if you're in Blackwater, you can kind of just torture someone and no one knows about it.
Yeah, right. probably Kofi Annan would then say, well, you can establish these cults. But right now, you're absolutely certain.
I'm just curious about the like sort of more philosophical aspects of war making. Do we, or when was the last time, or the recent times we've had wars that stood for certain principles, or like for justice, or certain values of international affairs?
Well,
versus it being like profiteering.
I think, can we put
aggression of the U.S.
Getting a cheese sandwich. I'm sure somebody in this room is really hungry and has a preference of 10 to get a cheese sandwich. You know, barely like hanging in there in the chair. It's like, yeah, I'm just sitting here to be polite, but actually, I'm going to get the cheese sandwich. And somebody else is kind of like, hey, I hate cheese sandwiches. You know, I'm really not interested in cheese sandwiches. No, my preference intends to get a cheese sandwich if you want. I think. For every single intervention we see out there, even a security situation, you can basically graph countries in a similar fashion. Okay? Some countries, they're really interested in right now in Syria. Okay? They really care. Actually, nobody's really interested in Syria. But you know, maybe it seems a bit more. Like Germany right now is actually quite interested in Syria because they have all these refugees and actually they want them to move home. So, or, you know, like there's a lot of debate in the United States, actually. I wouldn't say that they're at an 8, you know, but because of the elections, Syria has become a topic. Camps, they actually discuss it. And then you have other countries who are kind of like, yeah, you know, poor people in Aleppo, but we don't have the military equipment, we don't want to purchase it, right? We don't have the military, and we're in economic crisis. It's probably kind of a France or something like that. And then other countries, they really don't care. And then even, you know, you have a Russia or some other countries where even negatively, they're opposed, they have negative preferences of an international dimension in this area. Okay. And so here's the question. Sorry, this would be like negative here. Minus. So, and then the question is, how do many of these preferences come from? And here, this is crucial. Yes, Canada, the United States, and, you know, Germany, all somewhat similar countries. But when it comes to preferences for foreign policy, they really date back sometimes even centuries, right? Germany is still massively affected by the Second World War, right? And that is, you know, decades ago. And you have Spain, who is still interested in Latin America because they speak Spanish there, and they used to be the colonial powers, but as well, centuries ago. And France is extremely interested in their former colonies. The Dutch are interested in Indonesia, right? But again, centuries ago. And so you have these foreign policy preferences which are still extremely different. And some of them, however, like a lot of them, influence these preferences. Okay. And so even, you know, a lot of people always say, well, when you talk about diplomatic embeddedness, doesn't that mean that interests converge and become together because you're all friends and see each other all the time? And I would say no. Because an historical experience like Germany, you know, cannot just be overcome by meeting Americans, even on a day-to-day basis, right? Or the colonial experience of the French cannot just be, you know, wiped away by, you know, meeting the Brits all the time, right? These preferences are so fundamental to these states But in essence, yes, of course, you can maybe converge a little bit, but it doesn't mean that you have all the homogeneous preferences. In essence, this is kind of a world we live in right now. Okay, so we have these crises, and individual countries are more interested, and others are just, by definition, less interested. You know, and the preferences really, you know, depend on election cycles, on economic cycles, on the military, on, you know, you name it. And what happens then is these folks were really interested in it. Sometimes it's the United States, sometimes it's Canada, sometimes it is France, sometimes it is Australia. They want to go, right? And they sometimes even have moral reasons, humanitarian reasons to do it. But they don't want it to go alone, for what, just what we said, you know, legitimacy, cost concerns, insurance policy. And in essence, they have to pay or incentivize these countries that are lesser interested. And they have to chop them off, right? So that they all kind of reach. And this is the side payment, or this is the persuasion that, you know, like these guys are really interested in major production. So in essence, we don't live in a world right now of, you know, homogeneous threat perceptions or preferences. We live in a world of extremely diverse preferences. But still, there's this motivation for multilateralism for various reasons, right? But multilateralism only happens if you provide these extra incentives. Yeah?
Do you think these side payments take away from the legitimacy of coalitions? Is that just kind of like the business?
Yeah, but so, you know, I've been doing research on this for almost 8 years now. And what I've found, it's really hard because the United States doesn't want to talk about it because they want to pretend that, oh, all these guys, you know, came voluntarily, right? And they believed in the mission. Yeah? And the participants, right, they have sometimes a hard time admitting it as well because they don't want to say, like, yes, of course we got paid off by the United States. So you really have to go into archives, you have to know a lot of people that trust you, that then kind of reveal these side payments.
Right? Matthew, I just had a question.
You got a lot. Sorry, that wasn't part of the question. sorry about that. Okay, I was just curious to know, a lot of this was focused on U.S. relations building. Do you think this is applicable to lots of other states in the world and other great powers, and also, like, just in a historical context, like we were talking about the Cold War in particular, like how did the USSR, Soviet Union engage in this type of coalition building? Like, do you think, like, your model is, like, pretty applicable? Because I was thinking in my head, like, yeah, like, why not, you know? Like, what's your opinion?
So in my book, you know, about I look at Australia because I was interested in little power, building a coalition for the East Timor intervention. It was very simple. You know, they had a little bit of a harder time than the United States because they have less of those, you know, hierarchical relationships. But as well, they have to pay the Thai and the Philippines and, you know, the South Koreans to deploy there, the Kenyans actually, the Jordanians. And, you know, Canada participated as well in East Timor. And even Saudi Arabia deployed to, was bombing still Yemen, right? People don't really talk about it, but maybe. And it is as well a coalition, right? You have the UAE, and you have, I think, even Egypt participating in that. They engaged as well in these negotiations. You know, it's an illusion to think as well that Egypt just volunteered and said, oh, of course, help you bomb Yemen, you know, knowing that Saudi Arabia still has a lot of.
Yeah, sorry. So you talked about, like, buying or bribing, like, the alliances. And what about, like, factor of common enemy or natural alliance? I'm thinking now economic embargo against Russia and or, like, Ukrainian crisis. So my question, the role of the...
I think, again, identical, you know? Not everybody in NATO agrees with this picture of now Russia being evil. In one way or another, the United States is probably one of the proponents. And so we have, the John McCain, John McCain, he's vocal on, you know, like the anti-Russia stance. But then you have, you know, Germany, for example, is split. Angela Merkel says, yes, we have to deal, harshly with Russia, but then you still have more the social democratic front, and the former chancellor of Germany, Schröder, who's still best friends with the Russians, because there's a lot of trade going on between Germany and Russia, and the same goes in France and Italy, you know. So there's, in Europe, you have Poland and the Baltic states, you know, who would be out here, and then the United States, and you're really anti-Russia. But then a lot of other countries would actually say, oh, you know, maybe they're not like that. So again, there's no common front. It's an illusion to think that NATO has, you know, these predefined threats. In the Soviet era, it was probably a little bit different, but today, I think that's just okay.
Zunaira had a question. We have time maybe for two or three more.
I was wondering, with your work, when it comes out, I wonder if, whether you're targeting certain decision makers within the international sphere, and whether you're looking for a certain kind of response or hoping that it would, this research would influence certain aspects of war making, whether it's from like people like ourselves, just everyday people, or like other academia professionals.
I think first, what I'm interested in is kind of like, you know, probably you might be, you know, you all seem like pretty decent, and maybe even idealistic students. And you might be wondering, so why does nothing happen in Aleppo, right? I mean, why do they just like let these poor people die? I think it's pretty tragic. You know, maybe you're interested in another conflict as well, I don't know, in Darfur or something else, and you're asking these questions, you know? And what I want you to understand is that intervention is to be motivated, right? So it's not Kofi Annan or Ban Ki-moon at the UN, so we're gonna intervene, you know. Unfortunately, Ban Ki-moon is in this respect completely powerless, okay? Why? Because the UN doesn't have any troops. Every single troop needs to be provided by a country. And somebody needs to then recruit these troops. And Ban Ki-moon doesn't have the resources to recruit them either. So you need to have powerful states who somehow coalition who are really interested in this, you know, these lead states who push for it. So in essence, you know, like you wonder why nobody does something about it. It is because you don't have a lead state or a lead coalition from these couple who are really pushing for this. That's the question. So it's not the international community, but every single intervention that you saw, whether it was in Bosnia or in Kosovo or in East Timor or in Rwanda, you know, like the non-intervention, the absence of these actors, okay, and I think this is for you very important. How do interventions come about? Well, you need states who take the initiative. Okay? It's not the fault of the international community. You can have amazing idealists demonstrating on the street, but if you don't put pressure on governments, nothing happens. Yeah.
Would you say that in regards to Ukraine, that's the lack of interest?
Absolutely.
There's no intervention?
Yeah, absolutely, and you know, like, so interest is always like, so people are interested, you know, but are they interested in pushing back Russia? That's the question right now, you know. Russia, to a certain degree, is, you know, Putin is a very strategic player. So Putin, you know, the Germans used to be, Merkel, they used to be quite harsh on Russia, right? They were pushing for the sanctions of the EU. And what you need to know is, like, the EU has Russia really depends economically on the EU, not so much on the United States and Canada, right? So the trade relations in Russia and the EU are much, much more dense than, you know, with the side of the Atlantic. So if the EU imposes sanctions, really sanctions, it would hurt Russia. So in the beginning, the Germans were pushing for it quite harshly, and it was quite novel. But then all of a sudden, Putin became a player in Syria. And the Germans were really worried about Syria as well, because they have all these refugees, and in particular domestically, right? So there's a big backlash now against Merkel and refugee policy, and what she was doing with refugees. So in essence, Germany wants that they leave again, you know, that they go home. But for them to be able to go home, they need to deal with Russia, right? Because Russia is now a key player in Syria. And Russia says, well, you know, we only create peace in Syria if you stop with your sanctions. All of a sudden, they have leverage again. Do you get that? So if the Germans pushed harder on the sanctions, then Russia would say, well, your dream of sending your refugee home is like, forget. So basically they have to take off the foot of the gas pedal so that Russia then maybe, you know, like try somehow to negotiate something in Syria so that these folks can go home. You know, so it's all kind of interrelated. Yeah.
How do you think this reflects on the value of military alliances specifically for America? Because it does seem to me that the military alliances, and especially NATO, are actually fairly costly for America in terms of security commitments and overseas deployments and things like that. But you, just for geographical reasons, if nothing else, America is not really vulnerable to any direct threat that could make these commitments reciprocal. So America's needs are these interventions. But as you're saying here, alliances like NATO are actually completely worthless in terms of gaining assistance for these interventions. So do you think that sort of maybe might bring into question whether these alliances are really useful for America or not?
Yeah, so, completely worthless is a little bit of like a very stark term. So I'm not saying that NATO is completely worthless. And I think, it's, again, every kind of international organization, is maybe Bob Cohen, but, it fosters information exchange, it creates trust, there's socialization dynamics and all these kind of things, right? What I'm saying is NATO does not, lead to the convergence of security interests, right? So that's an illusion, right? So it's not only because you have NATO, everybody believes that Saddam Hussein is a threat, everybody believes that Russia is a threat, They can push it and maybe, they are, they inch, a little bit closer together, but it cannot shift the entire, historic structures that, in essence, then lead to these preferences, right? So France will never give up its interest for its French colonies, former French colonies, and Germany will never overcome its Third Reich experience because of NATO, right? They will not become, all of a sudden, a gang-ho, kind of interventionist country. So these kind of things. Maybe in a, over, 500 years is a different question, but not, in the time span. So this is what I think when you talk about alliances and about NATO as well. But it has other benefits. For example, the U.S. Defense business. Through NATO, they can sell a lot of their stuff to NATO countries, So it has other benefits that are very interesting, But it's not, guaranteeing this preference convergence. I think this is what it's called. So NATO allies still need, incentives. I think this is what it's called.
And so then, following from that, like, would you say that diplomatic readiness an alliance like NATO leads to more diplomatic embeddedness because there's more information and better information because they're always at these conferences, and so it makes it more likely that alliances will seem to affect the relationship, but really it's just the fact that they're so in contact.
Exactly. It's like a lubricant, right?
Yeah.
So all these guys still need, their little incentive to participate, but yes, because they're meeting in Brussels and they're meeting, at some other summits, these that they create, among others, like the UN General Assembly or, like a WTO summit and whatnot, they create venues where these incentives can be negotiated, right? Because it's not evident. The United States is every single time they're worried that they get ripped off, in these side bank negotiations. So if you have these settings where there's a certain trust relationship that is information, right? The negotiation of these side payments is key. That's the quintessential, coercion action.
Do we have time for one more?
Yeah.
May I ask? can we go back to our friend, German friend Max Weber? Right?
Huh?
So he would say this is all true, but information is not meaning. Some preferences are so embedded that you don't need social relations for them. Are going to be high. So Britain sending 45,000 troops to Iraq, Operation Teller. What exactly do they get in return, right? So it's, perhaps I think there is definitely a political economy behind participation in U.S.-led coalitions. But sometimes there's something else at play. Maybe values, maybe norms, maybe the fact that they share meanings. This is the right thing to do. We're a force for good in the world. Let's intervene in a big way.
Let's finish that. It's very optimistic.
Right. Okay. Well, thanks very much. Join me in thanking Professor Hanke. There's another talk by Professor Kontlapki, Stephanie Kontlapki, on the fourth floor. It's on the Obama.